Don't do ouchies anymore. No, no, don't do ouchies anymore. No, no. We're going to have to solve that problem.
Hey, welcome everybody to another episode of How Did You? And today the question is going to be, how did you discipline your kids? And I have the honor of interviewing Dad. It feels like I scored like the ultimate interview, like the president or something. So today I wanted to ask you some questions just to bounce off of us talking to mom too. Stick around to the end because I want to share a little story about one time that I should have been disciplined when I was 5 or 6 years old.
Oh.
I won't give away the story now, but I definitely deserved a punishment. When we were little kids, was it like a good cop, bad cop thing? Or can you tell me a little about that?
Well, I didn't think of it in terms of cops. I know what you mean by good or bad cops. We just really loved you all.
Yeah.
And wanted so much for you to reach your full potential.
Left face. Javier, turn around, honey.
We did have sort of an unwritten rule that if one parent was disciplining, the other wouldn't. She'd be the comforter, or she would discipline, and I would say, hey, let's pray about that. And when she would discipline, it wouldn't be that much difference. It just wasn't like she was a raging, angry monster, and I was this gentle dad, let's go play catch and get an ice cream cone. So we usually found, we kind of knew we could play off of each other.
I guess it probably was a different dynamic for the mom and the dad, because you were out running the business a lot. You were out doing depositions and other things for your work.
Yeah.
So you'd come home and maybe you didn't know the things we did that day.
Right.
So did you have to kind of coordinate with mom, or how would that work where you'd know like what level of discipline to give or not to give?
Well, a lot of times you can almost pick it up. I think God puts radar and for a Christian, there's discernment through the Spirit, but just you sort of pick up, what does this son need right now? And you could kind of see that what I often would pick up is the same, at the same time, even before she would say, so-and-so didn't do his schoolwork, I'm gonna have to really help him buckle down and take that seriously. I already would have sensed that son just wasn't as proud of himself when I would come in the door, couldn't quite look me in the eye, and didn't feel, if I did offer him, hey, you wanna go play catch, he would almost feel a little like he didn't deserve it. And so then I would just say, we'll go into the other room and say, oh, what's going on with Paul? He seems, and then
I'm sure I never need discipline. I'm sure never.
She might say, well, he's way behind on math, and he's been kind of discouraged, and he just wondered if he could just be off for the whole day. And I told him, no, sit there. These are the times when you need to plow through. And then he kind of got a little disenchanted with that. And
were there any times, like when you first started out as a parent, I guess when I was born,
yes,
you must have been, what, 24,
yes.
I think?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Uh-oh, big car. One.
Wow.
He handled that one.
Can you think of any major like checkpoints along the way where you noticed, like maybe when you were 44 compared to when you were 24? Because of course you were a brand new parent. I'm sure you learned tons of things along the way.
Yes.
I don't know if that's a fair question, but can you think of any major things you kind of learned that you might save some other people from?
Well,
learning the hard way.
Well, one thing I learned is that I was too naive very early. Mm-hmm. I learned to get out ahead of things.
Sure.
And because there were times when I sensed that, maybe it was just God putting it on my heart, but I just sensed that he doesn't look transparent right now.
Like he doesn't look himself, or looks like he feels bad about something.
Yeah, it's harder to look in, look me in the eye. He doesn't seem transparent. He's kind of murmuring the words. It's something that I've learned is true as
sure.
I look back. As I look back, I usually had to reverse engineer, and then sort of if mom didn't know what it was, we would both kind of just keep tuned in and kind of keep loving you. Then I'd find out maybe there was something that he had not felt completely comfortable, mm-hmm. Maybe just something he wasn't proud of at all. Or
sure.
In one case, one of the guys had been maybe a month behind in his school or at work. And it would be an explosion of tears when he kind of confessed.
Yeah.
But then we were able to get in and really help him.
Were there a lot of times that you had to like give punishments or disciplines, or like what were some of the main things that you had to, I'm thinking more like when we were little kids,
yes.
What were some of the common things that came up?
Well, I think the biggest thing that I would always notice first that I prioritized was forgiveness and love and not holding any anger. And we basically would talk about that constantly, as you might remember. We would have nightly gatherings, and we called them our prayer time, and mm-hmm. I would tell you stories in your room and yeah. while you're in bed. I tried to lead by relationship, by just bonding and having such an intimate, like I would share. One of my tricks was, I would, not even a trick, mm-hmm. but it worked. I shared my heart, even as a dad. I trusted you were my confidant.
Because it looks like maybe someone like Jack Kemp could run in 1996.
I damn quail.
And I hope he is a pro-lifer. He used to be, and I hope he sticks that way. Or quail, possibly, or other candidates, or a guy named Bill Bennett. Yeah. And I've been doing some writing since then on a book that is a secret. I'm not going to tell anybody the title until it's finished. And what else have we been doing? Let's see, we've been making lots of fires. Oh yeah, we're about to mail a picture of the whole family for our business Christmas mailing. For the first time, we're going to do it in color.
So if I had some decision to make, I felt like, hey, it just seems like we should go this way with our business. And I trusted that kids, you know, you have to, people underestimate their intelligence. Many times kids have that innocent clarity of vision. It's adults who sometimes think too much about something. And I would just ask, you know, what do you think we should do? And you think we should, you know, take this deposition? It's been offered to us. It would mean traveling to Colorado. And would you all be up for a trip to Colorado? And, yeah. And then mom would say, well, you'd have to really, really behave in the car. You know, it's going to be a long drive. So we kind of came to decisions together. I tried to make you all feel as if I was entrusting everything to you, with opening my heart, bringing you in on the process of something. And that made you all feel convicted that you, if you were holding something back from your dad and mom. And you would often cough it up, or maybe I'd take a drive with you and you would, while driving, just get real quiet and I'd say, oh, is there something you want to tell me? And you'd maybe tear sure. up and say, yes, there is.
Yeah, sure. So yeah, basically that you would, if you build up that closeness in a lot of small ways, then it makes it easier to share things with each other.
Yeah, when you have a daily relationship, even an hourly relationship, it's hard for things to get very big and out of control as far as unknowns between two people.
I was going to ask, like when we were very small, of course, like I guess discipline was more kind of remedial, like very basic, where like maybe a slap on the wrist type of thing, or like, hey, no, you can't do that. There's a famous time of Philip with a bowling pin. Yeah. We called him Winnie the Pooh because he just looked like this little friendly, chubby guy in suspenders.
Yeah, and he would be, he was so sensitive. Like we would watch a Disney cartoon, Peter and the Wolf, and he would hide under a table and look at the wolf, but then comfort his brother and say that as long as he stays behind the glass of the TV, he can't get us.
Yeah.
he's just a little ball of you know, butter in a way, and just such a cheery disposition with blonde hair. But he would hit.
No. No. We're gonna have to solve that problem.
And I would reward instead of being negative, I would light one candle rather than curse the darkness, which is what we tried to do over the years with you guys. Give you something aspirational, something to rise to, to make dad and mom proud.
Oh, come here. You get two quarters. You not fight back?
I said, you know, James, because he's expected to be in on it with me. He's older. James, that's so. Sure. I'm so proud of you. You get a quarter. I'm going to give you a quarter for that. For not fighting back. And then, so, you know, but I guess I was too trusting that little Philip would be convicted and say, yes, I too should be more forgiving. And then I must have lost, turned the other way. And before I knew it, they were in the other room. And all I know is I saw James go from one side of the room to the other and disappear past the French doors into another room. And then I think Philip picked up his club.
Yeah. Uh-oh, I better help.
It's premeditated.
Oh, yeah.
And it gave me a different view of my loving little Philip.
Don't do ouchies anymore. No, don't do ouchies anymore.
Yeah, that's so funny because Philip was one of our most peaceful sons, but at that age he was...
I can imagine as a parent that's like one of many examples of like learning things along the way that'll always trying to find the right balance.
What I always did was I would open up and not treat you as just little kids. I would talk to you as adults in my drives or our nightly chats and say, what do you think about this? Hey, we might do this, and then I'm going to finish this job, and then we'll go out to the park and we'll practice baseball. You think that'd be good? So if you hear the videos, I'm actually talking to you guys. the most I can. You know, if they're little, I might have a little sing song in my voice, but I think you handle it real well. I still feel bad that one time we were in Colorado in '88. I was covering a depot, and Mom went into, it was in Colorado Springs, and you guys were in the car, and I was like, of course, we had just driven all the way out there and everything, and we had been out there for a while, but you guys were not in your normal pattern, but somehow you were acting up a little in the car. So I just gave you a little swat, and I felt a little bad about it. So I apologize.
That was
Colorado Springs. Colorado Springs.
I probably deserved it, though. I should apologize.
Colorado Springs, Long John Silver's.
Okay, I don't remember it, so it must not be too deep of a scar.
I think it was Long John Silver's. I think it was on the North South Road. It was probably to the east of the North South Road.
Okay, well, I probably deserved it because
Long John Silver's is there anymore.
You had so few times of ever even just like a little pat. You were such a like softy in a way that the few times that you would, I can only remember a few times where. Like I felt like I disappointed you where you were kind of upset with me, but even then it was like so rare and it was so like the punishment in a way. It's like, I know it's kind of a cliche, but like the punishment was knowing that I disappointed you rather than like you like slapping me or anything, which you never, I can't remember actually any times. There must've been some little pats here and there, but like one time I remember in particular, I remember it was at our old house on East Adams Street.
Yeah, the old family homestead.
And you were away on a deposition, I'm sure, just working like crazy like you usually did, and I think you had just planted some grass seed the day before right under like on our main yard where we were always having trouble getting grass to grow.
Oh yeah.
And it was right under a basketball hoop, and I think you had told us to stay off of it, but I had somehow had some friends over from the neighborhood and it had just rained, so it was real muddy.
Oh yeah.
And I think one thing led to another, and somehow we ended up having like a big vigorous basketball game on the dirt and just completely like annihilated all, just turned it all into creamy like a mess and messed up the baby grass.
Yeah.
And I remember you got home and you were just kind of like disappointed, almost like, because you were probably looking forward to getting home and maybe like carefully watering it or something. Yeah. And I just remember feeling like oh yeah, I blew it there. And I just felt bad about it.
I just want to encourage parents not to get overwhelmed, because all you have to do is live one 5-minute section at a time. And people think, well, I could never have that many children. But after we got going, it was easier, actually, because...
Well, you learned a lot along the way, too.
And after you were age 6 or 7, you were actually helping. You were very responsible and protective as an older brother. You would go get a diaper to change this one and be very affectionate. And it flipped. And the toughest part was when we had 10 in a row, and you were the oldest at, 14. We had just welcomed children and really wanted to do that, and only had one used car. And so that was tricky.
Can you think of any like very specific times of discipline where somebody maybe later came back and thanked you, or that it's like a kind of a sweet memory in your mind between you and whoever it was?
I could think of a good one with Mary Elizabeth, and she was about 11 at the time. We were actually out of town in Virginia at a vacation house, looking, getting into the car and going various places, Civil War battlefields. And she was just enjoying the trip. There were snacks. And it was easier because we all wanted to stay in training. We played ball together. But boy, how do you bring that up to a little girl without, I don't want her to become an anorexic or have to, go through some trauma later. But anyway, I just decided, God seemed to give me a handle. I just said, I'm going to just approach this factually. I said, Mary Elizabeth, let me tell you something. There's a way you can get some really good deals with food. Yeah. So you see, they're not all the same calories. Like if you do eat that Hostess cupcake there, that's this many calories, and maybe I showed her on the peck. But if you would have this whole bowl of soup over here, and then this kind of dessert that has some sweetness, like maybe a bowl of popcorn. Well, maybe it's not sweet, but it's you can have all of this for the same amount of Hostess apple pies
is
did you know it's 480 calories? Wow. That's what it was when I checked 30 years ago. And so I just, for 480 calories, you could have a huge bowl of popcorn. And so I thought to myself, oh man, this is kind of heavy for an 11-year-old or whatever age she was. Is it just going to not seem like dad loves her and wants to take away her food? Mm-hmm. But later she thanked me and has since then thanked me over and over for opening her eyes to something that she could take through the rest of her life.
Yeah. And you guys did that for me too. Like early on, I remember maybe I'd put on a little bit of weight and I wasn't super aware of calories, but I think you and Mom said, hey, why don't we why don't we try this? Why don't we have, you know, 2,000 calorie limit and you just count your calories? Well, I wanted to, before we got too far, I wanted to give the story that I promised. And this goes back to when I was, I think, I'm going to guess I was 7 or 8 maybe. But for whatever reason, mom had been about to discipline me for some reason. I'm sure a very good reason. I'm not sure what it was, but I was kneeling on the ground. She was kind of kneeling down, correcting me. And I remember, I think I already was a little depressed or sad that I was going to get punished for something. And then I think she actually was also going to punish me for something else. So I was already frustrated. And then I remember feeling kind of indignant that I was going to be punished for something else unjustly in my mind. And so I think as she was correcting me for that second thing, I remember just like my little kid brain thinking almost like this is too much. And she's saying she's about to punish me. And I think I just went like this to her, just like kind of tapped her on the cheek. I mean, it was like about like that. It's not this slap really, but it was just like
logic.
All I remember was like, yeah, it was just like a little protest, like on the Disney movie Finding Nemo, where the dad told him not to touch the boat or whatever it was. And he just angrily like tapped it just to defy it because he was embarrassed and upset. But anyway, long story short, I just remember almost like slow motion that I couldn't, even as a little kid, thinking like, oh, what did I do? And almost like mom just in slow motion was looking at me. And all I remember is just running away. And I was like hiding behind her bed. And I knew she was like right behind me, like kind of coming after me. And I just remember saying like, no, mom, no, I didn't mean it really. I can't believe I did that. I'm so sorry. And she was kind of like storming. And anyway, but then she came up to me and I thought I would get the biggest punishment ever, but she actually had mercy on me. And I think she saw how scared I was and how sorry I was, that it was actually a tale of that I already had my punishment from my great fear.
Yeah.
And years later, I've talked to mom many times about it. And she said that when it happened, she was actually holding back laughter. But she had to almost, because she saw how terrified how pitiful that I just barely did that and just like was running away, kind of looked like a monster was chasing me.
Yeah.
And she said she had to almost like brace herself to look stern as she was coming toward me, just to make sure that I had the proper outlook on it.
Sure.
But anyway, that was just kind of a funny story that I look back on. So that was the time that I should have been disciplined, but mom had mercy on me. So she knew I learned my lesson.
That's how we try to do it, is let kind of build up instead of just destroy, because everyone has that nature we're born with. And our idea was to build the good side, because you had all received and welcomed help from God and received Jesus into your hearts. So we were trying to build the alternative. And we always called it, I like to call it replacement therapy.
Yeah. And mom mentioned that too when we talked to her just recently, but she was saying like the idea, of course, the idea of a punishment is not like you enjoy it. You aren't like getting back at a kid, or of course, it's nothing like that. It's just, she said like the minimum thing that would fix the problem.
Yes, you know? That's exactly how we felt.
And so that's basically what you described there too. So.
I remember once in a very Christian home back in the 1800s, there was this mother of 11, and she would, they say, basically govern the family by just slight look in the eye and a forefinger. Yeah. And just basically, if they were all like sitting at table, or if somebody was acting up, they had enough of communication where just a look would do it. And so that's how it soon got with our family. And I think, in fact, then being in the media a lot and doing interviews with national media, you know, some 20 years ago, and over since then, all sorts of interviews, everybody became very poised with being transparent on camera. And that was a continuation of our transparency with each other. And so what we have is great communication here. We're talking often. We hang out together and play ball together. And it just would seem odd for me to hold anything big from any of you. I feel like I'm just talking to you now as we do when the camera's off. It just, you know, if you anything, any discipline, any sin, you're trying to conquer, if you can nail it in the small stage, or you're never going to have a monster to deal with.
Hey, thanks for watching today. Please hit the like and subscribe button if you like what you're seeing. You can also hit the notification bell. It'll make it easier for us to contact you.